Good afternoon. On behalf of Arts Empowering Life, welcome you to the new Performing Arts Center in Brewster. This is our first in-person lecture series that we've done this year. I'm so happy that you could join us. Last month, we had Dr. Sam Adler did a talk about his life in music, and it was so well received that he has agreed to do three more lectures with us. So if you look at the upcoming events, you'll see Dr. Sam Adler is going to be speaking on March 2nd, which is the first weekend in March. And then the next weekend, if you go to the Church of the Transfiguration, Arts Empowering Life's Gloria Day Cantores will be giving a Lenten concert that second weekend. And then the third weekend in March, come back here, Dr. Mark Kellogg will be giving a lower brass workshop in the morning, and then a lecture recital at 3:30 at the same time in the afternoon. But we welcome you to come to all of those things. Just another couple things before I get to welcome our guest, Dr. Susan Rogers, who I'm so excited for you all to hear about. We have a new Outer Cape Winds Community Wind Ensemble. If you play an instrument, if you ever played an instrument and you would like to see if you could find that in your cedar closet or under the bed, pull it out. Join us. We play here every Tuesday evening from 5 to 7. We would absolutely love to have you. This is our first lecture that we've had sponsored by a business. So we want to thank HSO Consulting for their sponsorship. And if your business wants to sponsor another upcoming lecture, let us know. We're always super thrilled for community involvement in that capacity. Now today, you've heard about Susan Rogers. I'm excited. Not only is she a recording engineer, but she is a doctor of cognitive science. She's gonna talk today about what you hear in music, why you respond in the ways that you do. You can read her bio there, but without any further introduction, I welcome Dr. Susan Rogers.
Everybody, thank you for coming. Thank you very much for showing up and for listening to me talk about what I hope is your own love affair, your love affair with music. So I'm going to be talking with you about music and things I've learned about how it works in our brains. I've had a love affair with music since I was a little kid. Maybe most of you have too. So while I'm talking, what I'd like you to do is think about those pieces of music that you just love like crazy, that just make you want to swoon, that just fill your heart, make you just hold your breath. Those pieces that for whatever reason struck you as being perfect for you. Because what I'd like to talk about is the music of you. In so doing, I'm going to be talking about how music sounds to me. But I've written a book about that, and it was not to let readers know, here's my taste in music, here's what I consider to be good and bad music. Not at all. I wanted to write about the musicality of listeners. I'm a non-musician. I took piano lessons when I was a little kid. Hated it. It resulted in pleasure for no one. I didn't like it. No one liked hearing me. But what I loved more than anything was listening to the radio and listening to records. I think I was born to be a record maker because being on input, receiving music, felt so good and still does. There is a role for us. For music listeners, those of us who consume music, have just as important a part to play in its life as the people who make it, in a sense. Food, when it comes out of the kitchen and sits there on the plate, isn't food. It becomes food when it's consumed. Now it's useful. Now it's serving a function. Now it's food. And it's the same thing with music. Music played in an empty room with no one to hear it isn't really music. It's just a pressure wave going back and forth. Music is what happens up here when we listen to a signal, and as we say in the sciences, the signal becomes transduced. Oh, it decided to advance on its own. I didn't want that to happen. The music becomes transduced from being just a signal in the air and in our brains to being music. And sometimes, with some pieces of music, the feelings that we experience from it are those of love. It's a release of dopamine. It's a release of recognition. This is my music. This is me. How does that even happen? How can something come out of one person's brain, go into another person's brain, and have the recipient say, yes, you just expressed me and my life? It could be a composer who died years before you were born. It could be someone of a different gender or race or someone of a different nationality. Yet, the thing they create sounds to you as if it came from inside you. That's the incredible mystery and the beauty of music. So I'm going to talk about your musicality and the music that's inside you, expressed through the love of listening. And as you listen to the talk, I hope you're thinking about your musical loves. I'll be thinking about mine. Oh, I had a clicker, but I don't need it. I'll just push the button. So first, here's why I'm qualified to talk with you about these things. I started my career in Southern California. In 1978, I told you I loved records, the radio, like crazy, and I wanted to be, oh, there it is, thank you. I wanted to be a part of bringing that thing I loved into the world. I wanted to midwife records. I wanted to be there at the moment where they were coming into the world and help in whatever way I could. Well, that wasn't so easy for a young woman in 1978, whether or not you're aware. There aren't that many women record producers or recording engineers or mixers. The year now is 2024. You should have seen it in 1978. There really weren't that many. But that's okay. I could contribute by being an audio technician. I could contribute by studying electronics and repairing the equipment when it failed, because the tape machine or the console doesn't care whether or not you have a Y chromosome. If it's broken and you've got the schematics and the scope and you got the parts and you got the soldering iron, fix it. And if it's fixed, you've done your job. So that's how I got started. I'm grateful for that. Anyway, I got started, and then I was working for Crosby, Stills, and Nash at their studio in Hollywood in 83, 5 years after I began. And my favorite artist in the whole world was Prince. I was a big Prince fan, and I heard through the professional grapevine that my favorite artist in the world, Prince, was looking for an audio technician. Pick me, because he liked working with women. He liked giving outsiders a chance. And I was an outsider. You didn't see that many women in those roles, so he hired me, and I was with him. And we did Purple Rain, we did Around the World in a Day, and the Parade album, and Sign of the Times. I finally ended my relationship with Prince. It was amicable, but I needed a proper life. He worked constantly. So I left him, 88, came back to Los Angeles, and I worked as a recording engineer, a record producer, a record maker with David Byrne and Barenaked Ladies and quite a lot of artists, and I loved it very much. I had big success financially with Barenaked Ladies in 98. We had a big hit record. Before Napster, sorry, youngsters, those were the golden days. When you made a hit record back in those days, the producers got a lot of money. I don't know how it works today, but anyway, we used to get a lot of money, and with that money, I was able to change careers. So, in the year 2000, I entered college as a freshman at the University of Minnesota. Go Gophers. It's so cold there, the students have to go to their campus buildings underground through tunnels. It's so cold in Minnesota in the winter. So we were the Gophers, and I got my degree in psychology and neuroscience, experimental psychology. And from there, I went even further north up to McGill University in Montreal. McGill is the home of the greatest collection of music perception and cognition researchers. every university town has its specialty, and Montreal just happens to be music perception and cognition. So I got my PhD at McGill, studying with some amazing people. And then I came a little bit south. I came to Berkelee College of Music, where I met the wonderful Dan Pfeiffer, who is typical, not quite, of our amazing students. And I taught at Berkelee in two departments. I taught music production and engineering, which was my virtual PhD. And then I also teach or have taught psychoacoustics and music cognition, and so all of that. And then the third part of my career is going on concurrently, but I was invited by a professional co-author to write a book about music. And I said, well, you don't want me. Ask my students. They know more about music than I do. But what I can write about is music listening, because I don't know music theory. I don't play an instrument. But I've been a professional listener my whole life, which sounds funny. A professional listener, it's like saying, I'm a professional person who looks at things. There it is. It's right there. How hard is that? Listening, actually, when it's done right, is not merely a passive activity. When it's done right, it's active, not passive. Because, and the neuroscience shows us this, when we listen to a piece of music that we love, it happens just the way it feels like it happens. In other words, you go into your own head. There's a network of structures in our brain called the default network. If there are any neuroscientists in the crowd, you'll know what I'm talking about. The default network turns on whenever we go into our own heads. It's concerned with our self-image and our self-consciousness. It's you. Your default network. It starts forming when we're very young. Music is instrumental in helping to shape our self-consciousness, as I'll show you in a moment, and who we are. Anyway, it's estimated that we spend 30 to 50% of our time, if not more, in our own heads. That's what a brain does. So statistically, 30 to 50% of you right now are not listening to me. You're in your own heads. That's what we do. That's normal. We focus on the outside world, and then we go into the inside world. That's just what a brain does. When we listen to the music that we love, it lights up that default network. And there you are, in that private place where only you have ever been. No one else will ever be there, no matter how close they are to you. The privacy of you sometimes has a little companion, and that's the music you love. This has been shown in fMRI studies. Anyway, I get so excited about it, I go on a little too long, but that was the psychedelic camouflage cover of the book, which is called This Is What It Sounds Like, What the Music You Love Says About You. When I'm finished giving this presentation, I'll ask some of you to tell me about your musical loves, and I'll show you an example of one of mine. This famous photograph, Children at a Puppet Show, 1963, is what one of my musician friends said. If you're a musician and you're on stage performing, that's what you want to see. That is what you want to see. How great would that be? But as we know, when we're putting music, a lecture, anything out there in the world, food, anything, these are big reactions. Are they the same reaction? Might not be. Might not be. So, the little one up there at the top, he looks like, yes, he's got his hand up there in a gesture of triumph. Yes, I approve of whatever it is I'm seeing on that puppet stage. But the little one in front is like, no, she's got her hands up in kind of a defensive position. The corners of her eyes are turned down. I'm not sure she's got the same reaction. And then this fellow over here is like, oh, this is all just, I think this is a little too much for me. And this one is, what is this? And then the youngest one is like, I don't know, what am I even looking at here? So when we play the music that we love more than anything else for other people, their reaction might be that. Someone might say, yes. Someone else might say, are you kidding me? really? You like this? Someone else might be, oh, this is noise to me. And someone else might be, I don't get this piece at all. Isn't that what makes music so beautiful? It's the variety of the listening brains that give us the variety of music that we enjoy so much. So, while I was at McGill, learning from these incredible researchers, I learned that there are at least 7 different dimensions of recorded music, and sometimes I'll use the word record, and when I say record, I don't mean vinyl, I mean a recording of music, so it can be streaming or cassette or whatever you like. When we're listening to recorded or even live music, there are 7 different circuits in the brain, each one of which can independently ping your dopaminergic reward system and release just a little bit of dopamine. And when that happens, that little trickle of dopamine comes out, it tells your auditory cortex right here above your ears and your motor cortex up here at the top, it tells them, more of that, yes please. Whatever that was working for me. Let's hear more of that. It's this process of listening to music, moving your spotlight of attention around these different elements, finding, in some cases, only one element that appeals to you, that makes your brain say, yeah, that'll do it for me. I like this. Now, liking is different than wanting. Liking is a simple hedonic response. I like vanilla ice cream. But wanting, it's a more powerful response. When you want something, it means you'll work to get it. You'll spend time or money. You'll sacrifice something else in order to have the thing that you want. So sometimes, if more than one of these elements is excited by the record you're hearing, you might say to yourself, oh, I need this. This must go into my personal library because I need to hear this again. So I'm going to go individually around these 7 elements, but essentially the process works like this. If you walk into a room and music is playing, let's say people are talking and it's a cafe and there's cutlery going on and glasses and footsteps and all kinds of noise, but your auditory system can pick out the musical signals from that mashup that's going on in your brain. You pick that out and you perform scene analysis. That's immediate. It happens in under a second. So that, for survival's sake, you know that there's nothing dangerous in this room and that the sounds you're hearing include music. So if you're not interested in the conversation that's going on, you might move your spotlight of attention over to the music to listen to it. So after scene analysis, the next thing that also happens in under a second, because that's a long time to a brain, is timbre. What instruments am I hearing? Is this electronic music? Is it an orchestra? Is it a jazz combo? Quickly, automatically, you might hear that, well, there's saxophone and a vocal, and maybe there's acoustic guitar. From there, in the brain, the signal is routed to a number of different places, to different circuits that specialize in a kind of analysis. So for nearly all of us, if there's lyrics, it's going to be over here, the left hemisphere, left temporal lobe right above your left ear. You can focus on the lyrics. Or you move that spotlight of attention over to the melody and the harmony over there, for most of us, on the right-hand side. Maybe it's the rhythm that you like. And your motor circuits are imagining, how would I move to this? Are they in the pocket? Are they in time? Do I like where they're putting those accents? Does this feel good to me? You can also stylistically move your spotlight of attention to just the overall aesthetics. Is this a novel approach to this? Maybe they're doing a classic song, Girl from Ipanema or Ipanema or something like that. Is it novel or is it the traditional form? Authenticity, I'll show you in a moment. Do I believe these performers or are they just phoning it in? And realism has to do with recorded art, as I will show you. So you move your spotlight of attention and what you're doing is you're listening for a treat. Do I have a treat anywhere in this? Does anything about this please me? And if the answer is yes, you say, all right then. All right, that's not bad. And you'll keep listening. And if the answer is no, there are no treats to be found in this music, you'll turn to the conversation or your phone or something else. So now let me go through the seven dimensions, and again, I hope you'll be thinking about the music you love and thinking about which dimensions are particularly attractive to you in music. We'll start with authenticity. Authenticity refers to something that we used to say in the recording studio. We'd be listening to musical performances, and sometimes you're in that control room and you can hear, those musicians are bored. Yeah, they're technically good. They're hitting the right notes at the right time. They're not paying attention, are they? This music has no pressure. They're not feeling it. Come on. And you get down on the talk back if you're the producer and you say, come on, wake up, dig in. Dig in. You're playing me to sleep here. And then they'll put a little bit of gusto in it. When they put that gusto into it, where's it coming from? Is that singer singing her heart out? Bass player, are you flirting with me on that bass? You better be. If this is a love song, you better flirt with me on that bass. Piano player, where's your dynamics? Are you feeling this? Come on, that was a sad moment there. Come on, resolve that chord. Come down with it. Come on, tell me the truth. Tell me the truth with your fingers. That's what we're listening for. We're listening for the authenticity, the sincerity in the performance. Now, sometimes we say that the performance comes from the neck up. And what that means is it is technically perfect. Beethoven composed from the neck up. Sometimes we say it comes from the neck down. I put two iconic musicians up here to illustrate that point. There is the goddess Ella Fitzgerald over there. Technically as good as it gets. I can't listen to her without just tears coming down. Oh, so good. Otherworldly good. Technical perfection can make us cry. That's music from the neck up, as good as it gets, same as Beethoven and his compositions. Now we got Howlin' Wolf over here. I feel the same way about Howlin' Wolf. And that's music from the gut, from the belly button, from the heart. That's taken all of that Memphis and the South up through his feet, and he's delivering it on stage. Now that man was a gentleman. And he dressed when he got on stage, and he practiced. He was no less technically inclined than Ella, but his music came from what sounds like a lower place. We may have preferences on the dimension of authenticity. For me, I liked the Rolling Stones better than the Beatles. I was chastised for that at a dinner party in Boston once. I can't help it. The Rolling Stones seem to come from the gut, and I prefer that. Beatles seem to be more cerebral. And it's not my favorite. Not to say that one is better or worse than the other. They're not. We have our preferences, our sweet spots on these dimensions. Realism versus abstraction is a relatively new distinction in music, but it happened in painting 150 years ago. So in 1803, J.M.W. Turner was a British painter, and he did what the painters of the time did. He took his easel and his paints down to the pier, and he painted what he saw, which was an English packet arriving. It's a ship coming into the harbor, and you see, well, there's the waves, and there's the pier, and there's the boats, and there's the women there, and the ropes, and he painted reality. That's what it looks like. And then somebody came along in the 1840s and said, check this out, and showed him a new technology, a camera. The little wooden box, and you just squeeze this little bulb, and poof, there's a picture of your family. Whoa. Because J.M.W. Turner made his living, like painters did, by getting hired to come into your home and sit there every day for a week and paint your family. And now this guy comes along with this new technology, squeezes this bulb. Hey, there you go. There's your picture of your family. Oh, no. Most painters were quite demoralized. Figuring they're out of work because the new technology can capture reality better than they ever could. But J.M.W. Turner said, no, 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 not me, not me. I'm not out of work. I'm free because now I don't have to paint what the world looks like. I can paint what the world feels like. And he took his same easel and his paints and he went back to that same spot on the pier and he painted what is considered to be one of the first abstract paintings. That's what a snowstorm at sea feels like. The stories of him putting his head out the window of a train to feel the wind on his face and tying himself to the mast of a ship, to feel the world so that he could paint what he felt. I learned about that in a great book by the Nobel laureate, Eric Kandel. And when I read that, I went, yeah, the same thing happened to me in my generation of recording engineers. We were trained in the late 20th century to capture reality. We had to position those microphones exactly as Dan and I were talking about this earlier, as Dan does in the church, and what it's like to capture, here's what it really sounds like, and it was impossible. You can be really smart and have the best equipment, but to capture what it really sounded like in the studio was hard. The ones who did it the best, they were the engineers who won all the Grammys. And then somebody came along with that new technology, sitting right there, and said, hey, check this out. You want a perfect kick drum? Dink, dink, dink. Let me just push this mouse. It's right there. You just got a sample. You want horns? Oh, it's right there. It's in that thing. Oh, come on. All those skills that we worked so hard to master. But many record makers said, no. This isn't the end. This is the beginning of something brand new. And today, our records are sometimes the traditional kind. That's the kind I prefer personally. I like to listen to music and visualize the performers. Since I was that high, that's what I've done. I was born to be a record maker. I like to picture who's singing and playing to me. That's a treat. I like those realistic records because I want to be there in front of musicians when they're performing. But most of the students at Berkeley, they're the new generation. They don't want to see the performers. They want music that has been polished and refined, replaced, timing corrected, pitch corrected, to no longer reflect reality, but to reflect the idea of music more than the reality of people being in a room and playing together. There's no better or worse. There are just these differences in our preferences. Some people prefer more abstract music, some people prefer more realistic, and the same thing with painting and other kinds of art. Check the time. I think I'm okay. So this is the third of the aesthetic dimensions, and that has to do with novelty versus familiarity. We all have appetites for risk-taking, and that appetite can be different in different modalities. So sometimes you might be very conservative when it comes to how you dress, and you might be very risk-taking when it comes to your favorite foods. You'll try anything. You might be very conservative with your taste in music, and you maybe only like art films, or maybe you like abstract paintings and the Jackson Pollock action paintings of splashes on the canvas. We all have a preference for the familiar versus the novel. When it comes to music, we can plot the famous Wundt curve or the bell curve of behavior. We can plot stimulus complexity on the x-axis, and we'll put record sales, consumption, on the y-axis. Pop music is popular. It appeals to the greatest number of people at any given time. And it's going to be a mixture of enough familiar elements that people can recognize, yeah, I know how to dance to this. I know how to sing along with this. Tonally, rhythmically, it might be conservative, but there might be, some of you may have experienced this, lyrics that are shocking. I have. I've heard some things that I've thought, what? What is this? Or it might be brand new sound design. It's just a blend of novelty and familiarity. That appeals to the greatest number of people, but there are folks like my brothers. My brothers like their classic rock. They're all in my age group, and they're staying on that left side of that curve. They'd rather have a familiar form. They'll take new music if it fits that familiar form that they love, rock music. I'm on the right side of that curve. I'd rather have innovation. I'll take technical imperfection if you give me an idea I've never heard before. Show me something brand new. I have an appetite for risk when it comes to music that they don't share. They have an appetite for risk when it comes to sports that I don't share. So we all have a sweet spot on that dimension of novelty versus familiarity. And as we're assessing new music, we're deciding whether or not it excites that sweet spot for us personally. Now I'll get to the four musical dimensions, and I'll go relatively quickly because I want to demonstrate for you what a record pull is and ask some of you to participate, and there'll be time for questions as well. So let's talk about the four musical dimensions and where you might get a treat based on those dimensions. Melody. The melodies that we love best are things we've acquired over our lifetimes. When we're little infants, in fact, even in the womb, because it's a liquid environment, and in the final trimester, a fetus can hear in there. Before we're born, before we're even out of the chute, we've heard mom's voice, and we've heard speech prosody and dynamics, and after we're born, oh, and by the way, we hear dad's voice too, because it'll transmit sound in the if dad gets close enough to the womb. Anyway, after we're born, we know what people are doing when they use their voices to warn us. Don't you dare get closer to that. To reprimand us. Don't ever do that again. To soothe us. To amp us up. It's time to wake up. Go outside. Those are culturally specific. There's some cultural generalities, but for the most part, they're specific to our culture. The composers, the musicians of our culture, write melodies and play their instruments in the same way to convey what they're feeling, the way we do with our voices. We use our voices to let others know, here's what's going on with us, here's what we're feeling right now. And also to broadcast to others, here's how I would like you to behave toward me. The animal community does this. Bees. I was talking with Brother Nate a couple hours ago. Bees, the buzzing of bees, let the beekeepers know if those bees are in a good mood or a bad mood. Anyway, our brains have evolved, and not just our brains. Studies have shown this with domestic dogs, to process the information, the words over here on the left, and the intonation, the emotion on the right. And dogs do the same thing for both dog and human voices. But when we hear melodies, sometimes that melody just speaks to us. In the recording studio, when you're producing artists, you will sometimes say, give me that vocal in such a way that someone who doesn't understand English knows what you're talking about. Deliver that performance and don't make it rely on the words. Show me with your voice what you're saying, what you're feeling. So the melodies we tend to love best are those that we recognize. We can love melodies from cultures that are not our own, but we tend to have the best accuracy when it comes to interpreting the music of our own culture because we're familiar with voices. Lyrics have to do with the principle of self-congruence. When we hear a lyricist, we either identify with those words or we don't. We tend to prefer the artists who reflect some aspect of ourselves. Now, that's not to say that that artist has to be the same race or gender or age or nationality. I love Lana Del Rey over there in the lower right-hand corner. I am not that woman. I am so not that woman. But a little part of me is, little part. And when I hear her and hear her lyrics, some little part of me recognizes, yes, that feels right to me. I haven't lived the life she sings about, but I know what she's talking about. And same thing, Bob Dylan with Drake, Caetano Veloso. I hear these words, and sometimes there's resonance, and I think, yes, I get that. In fact, with Caetano Veloso, I don't get that, because he's singing in Portuguese, and I don't speak Portuguese. But in that voice, I get it. I get it, and it feels like the music of me. It feels right to me. So the lyricists that we love tend to feel congruent with some aspect of ourselves that we recognize. I love Public Enemy. I love Chuck D. I remember first hearing Chuck D and thinking, yes, like the little boy at the puppet show, yes. What am I talking about? I grew up on the opposite coast. I'm a different gender, I'm a different race, very different experiences. What am I saying yes for? I don't know. That's the mystery of music, isn't it? His experiences on some level were the same as mine. Rhythm is the first of our musical behaviors to emerge. Little toddlers, nearly all of them, spontaneously try to move their little bodies in time with music. They don't do it very well because they don't have the muscular control yet, but there's something about that signal, something about that beat that makes them say, I want to be a part of this. If that isn't the most beautiful thing, I don't know what is. A little brain saying, yeah, that thing you're doing, me too. I want to participate. It's a human impulse for all of us, except for those poor, unfortunate few folks who are beat deaf. Beat deafness is a condition that's a little bit like dyslexia, a little bit like tone deafness. I think it's more rare than tone deafness. You can't extract a beat from music and you can't dance in time. That's unfortunate, but most of us can. Most of us can. And timbre, the final of the dimensions, is how things make noise. From the time we're born, we're little toddlers, we are getting the world to make noise so we can learn about different sizes and materials and how things make noise. We can tell that dad's voice is different from mom's. Grandpa's voice is different from our little brother or sister. So we're going to pull the dog's tail and we're going to throw things and bang on things to make things make noise. If you're in your high chair and you've got a sippy cup and it's plastic and you've just finished with your juice and you fling that thing and it goes dook, 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 dook on the floor, you're learning that a hollow plastic object makes a dook kind of sound and you're learning that mom reacts. What are you doing? But if you get your little paws on a glass and you send that to the floor, it makes a sudden crash and a splatter, a very different kind of sound. And mom has a very different reaction if you go flinging a glass. So you're learning about the physical world and how sounds correspond to events. Now I'm going to share with you, and I will finish in good time, I'm going to share with you a very crude schematic of how this might work. A given record comes along, as shown by the little record symbol, and you're performing that mental scan to decide if you like it or not. You're moving your spotlight of attention around its aesthetic dimensions. The little heart represents your profile, your sweet spot on that dimension. And by the way, the four musical dimensions, they're not bidirectional. There's more than just two melodies. Think of it as spherical. This is just for illustration purposes. But maybe you're listening to that performance and maybe your sweet spot is for below the neck. And this record is, it's kind of in the middle. Okay, it's got some passion in it, but you could use it a little bit more. You like realistic records. This one is a modern sampled record. You're not getting your favorite treat. You're not able to picture the musicians in the studio because there weren't any. There's just a vocal on there with these electronic instruments. Novelty, maybe you like a lot of novelty and this record gives you that. So you're like, all right, good. I'm liking it. Now for melody, maybe you like a wide sweeping melody. I'll show you one of my favorites in a moment. That's what I like. Maybe it's a rap piece with that's the melody of the lead vocal. And you're thinking, no, not for me. But we all have our preferences. Lyrically, it might match or not. Same thing with that groove. I personally like my snare to be just a little bit behind the beat on every hit. A couple of milliseconds. The late great drummer, Al Jackson, puts that snare right where I want it to be. And I go through the process that every listener does of anticipating, oh, this is going to be good, and here comes the snare, and it doesn't. It makes me wait a millisecond or two, and then it goes bam. Oh, that's my guy, Al Jackson. So sometimes that rhythm might be perfect, and the sounds, maybe you think, yes, I approve. That's the guitar tone I love. I don't like that other guitar tone. This is the one I love. So all you need is one. which is why most of us have a very great deal of variety in our music collection, because you've got some records for their rhythm, you got other records for their melody, some records for their performances. Of course, you're getting your treats in a lot of different places. So when I was writing the book, I asked some students and some of my colleagues at Berkeley, tell me what it sounds like to you. A record that you fell in love with and haven't stopped loving. Very much like romantic love. Your sweetheart's not perfect. Your friends may have told you so. Your family may have told you so. But your sweetheart just might be perfect for you. And it's the same thing with our musical loves. So this person says, when I listen to this, I feel seasick, I get chills, but for some bizarre reason, sometimes I chase that feeling. What could he be? Eventually, by Tame Impala. This one says, it's both threatening and inviting, but it conjures up a feeling of who I am. And he went on to say, like being both the mosquito and the blood that it seeks. Funkier than a mosquito's tweeter, Nina Simone. This one says, I get a feeling of empathy for the performance, but also a solitary feeling. There's so much internal adventure in there. He was talking about Mojo Pin by Jeff Buckley. This one says, oh, if you close your eyes and listen for the full 40 minutes, there's no way that you cannot cry. This was a student. What could it be? Goldberg Variations by Bach. This one says, it has a broodiness, a darkness, and I'm drawn to dark things. It sounds like it's speaking almost from beyond the grave. And she went on to say, like Emily Dickinson looking down at her own body. What record is this? Japanese artist Sheena Ringo, called Religion. This one says, oh, the feeling is solemn, but there's happiness and there's hope. If I knew that a nuclear bomb was coming, I'd put on that record. This person is saying, I'd be okay if this was the last thing I ever heard in my life. If you're a record maker, how do you make a record that makes someone say, I'd listen to this at the very end? What could it be? Broke Down Palace by the Grateful Dead. None of these records give me that feeling. They have their loves, I have mine, you have yours. The whole point is, that falling in love with music is like falling in love with your romantic partner. There is no best song. It's all good. If you love it, that's your musical self. That music that you love is your musicality, and you are musical. If you love music, you are musical. You might not play an instrument or write or sing, but you're musical. Music wouldn't exist without you. So if you like that sort of thing, my book is in the center with that wild cover. One of my doctoral advisors was Daniel Levitin, who wrote This Is Your Brain on Music, and it was very, very successful. That's a wonderful book. And then the great Nina Krause at Northwestern has a book called Of Sound Mind, How Our Brain Constructs a Meaningful Sonic World. These two on the flanks there are great scientists and writers. I flatter myself to have my book up there in their company. But if you like this thing, there's plenty more to learn in these books. And I thank you very much for listening, and thank you very much to Paul and Dan. Thank you. Okay. I mentioned the record poll. I write about it in the book at the very beginning. A record poll is similar to a song poll. A song poll is what musicians will do. They sit around, they pass an acoustic guitar around in the circle, and they would play a piece of music that they've just written or work in progress. They just play songs for each other. I learned something a little sad in Los Angeles in 1972 when Crosby, Stills, and Nash and Jackson Browne and all these great writers were up there, and they'd have a song poll and they'd pass the guitar around. They'd pass it over Joni Mitchell. Come on, boys. Wake up and smell the coffee. This is a great songwriter we're talking about here. Anyway, I probably shouldn't have even said that, but that's, you know, I mean, it's all in the spirit of truth. We women have had to work harder to be heard in the music business. Anyway, a record pull is like a song pull, but instead of playing a song, you're playing a record. So you get, it's usually people at the end of a session, so there might be half a dozen of you, and each person will bring a song, and when it's your turn, what you have to do, these are the rules, you have to play a record that you hope, anyway, your pull mates haven't heard. You don't want to play something that's, you know, very, very famous that everybody's heard. Pick something that might be an album cut, because you're turning your friends on to new music. But then what you have to do is you have to say why you love this record. And you can't just say, well, it reminds me of my friend or when I was in high school. No, 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 talk about the record itself. What is it about this, why this record and not that record? So say something about this record that makes you fall in love with it, as if you were describing your romantic partner. Well, he's just really, really smart. Doesn't have much else going for him, but he's really smart. He wouldn't say that, of course. But I'm thinking of someone special. You might say something that says, well, you know, there are these flaws, but this is great. So you would say that about this record, and then you'd play your record for your friends. And the great thing about it, and there's more than one great thing, but one, you're turning people onto music. Two, they get to hear what it sounds like to you. They get to go to your private place, your psyche, and experience what this record sounds like to you, because you've just told them. That's an act of generosity. So one, you're learning a little bit more about your friends, and two, they're learning a little bit more about you because you're brave enough to share something with them. So the thing I'm gonna, I don't have a favorite song, I don't know about you, there's just too many of them that are so great, but I just picked one almost at random, came into my head earlier today, a song called This Time I'll Be Sweeter by Angela Bofill. Angela, the great singer Angela Bofill, the reason I love it mainly is for its melody, it's a beautiful melody. I love her voice too, she's very expressive, but the reason this record gets me and still does is the authenticity. She's saying to a sweetheart, I'm sorry, I messed up, please take me back, I'll be better this time, I promise. And you hear in her voice the heartbreak, you hear the past. Every work of art should have momentum. You hear the backstory, just in the tone of her voice where she's saying, please. She sings, this time I'll be sweeter. I won't mess around, I won't let you down. Have faith in me. So her performance is a sweet spot for me. I really believe her sincerity. And this gorgeous melody, it rises and falls and it swoops, and the melody seems to match her tone of voice and the sentiment she's trying to express. Other records I like more for their groove, maybe for their lyrics, but this one I love for melody and authenticity and her vocal performance. So Dan, would you play the first minute of that, please?
Darling, can't you see what losing you has done to me? I'm not the same girl I used to be. Have a change of heart, don't leave me standing. Dark, don't let confusion keep us apart. Come back to me, and I'll guarantee all the tenderness and love you will ever need. This time I'll be sweeter.
it's 40 years old or more, I think. Gets me every time. Did you notice how long her phrases were? Not even taking a breath. That's Frank Sinatra level control. What a great jazz singer she is. How she takes that breath, like she's got that control to swing that melody up and down. That's perfection, technical perfection. Now, I tend to like my records to be a little more raw than that. But when it's great, it's great. And I really love that record very much. So that's what you would do in a record pull, although you'd play the whole thing and then you'd talk about it afterwards. I've enjoyed record pulls very much. And so now we're gonna have a little bit more of this record pull, and I'm gonna invite Paul. Come on up, Paul. And you've got a record for us that you love. Yep. And remember the rule, you gotta tell us why you love it like crazy.
Okay, thank you for this opportunity. You know, I've been thinking, she gave me a tip that we were gonna do this, so I've been thinking all week what record I love. It's like, I gotta listen to that Gabrielli album that we did, that I heard as a kid this age. It was the best of the Chicago Symphony, the Philadelphia Symphony, and the Cleveland. So until about 2 hours ago, that's what I wanted to play. And then I thought, no, I gotta play this Mahler II, the Resurrection Symphony. When I was in college in upstate New York, I would put on the cassette of Gilbert Kaplan's playing London Symphony, Mahler II, when we went up and back for 2 years. At the end of 2 years, I think that, you know how tapes, they ran out. So, and the whole symphony is you know, two cassettes. It's an experience. It talks about the resurrection and how great is that. But the movement that always gets me, and I asked Dan if he could cue that up, is the fourth movement that just starts with an alto. It's in German, so you don't even have to know what she's saying. It's this lovely low from the belly solo, and then it just follows with this brass chorale, low brass chorale. You would think, because I'm a trumpet player, you'd think loud, high, fast trumpet music. But just take a listen and see if your heart works. Goes on, but that moment, if you listen to it in context, there's the banging drums, there's the apocalyptic, but then there's that moment. Yes, the resurrection will happen.
Let me ask you a question. Yeah. When you hear that and that moment comes, what do you see in your mind's eye?
I see light. I see sort of like I'm looking through the woods out these windows right now. There is a light that sort of is very picturesque.
I love that. I did research with my writing partner for the book, asking people, what do you see in your mind's eye when you listen to your favorite music?
Yeah.
Ever since I was little, I've always seen the performers, and I did right now. I'm picturing the orchestra. But you get your treat from the places where this takes you.
Yeah.
That is just such a big part of why you love it so much.
Yeah.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah,
all right.
Thank you.
So, can we call upon some of you to share? Please share with us.
Peg by Steely Dan. I know it's not obscure.
So good. And why? What does it do?
We're gonna get a microphone here.
Peg by Steely Dan.
Peg by Steely Dan.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Yes, Peg by Steely Dan from the 70s.
Why that song and not another song?
Because everything about it is tight, sophisticated, intentional, and a little bit smart aleck.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of, look what I can do, that really, what do you see? I see this bright white spot.
Really?
That's,
That's great. Isn't it funny how, just how our minds are so different and how we are searching for treats? When we bond to music that we love, it means your brain found one. You go to that default network, you light it up, it listens to the music, and there are other songs, other Steely Dan songs that are good, that fit some of that same criteria. But this one, your brain said, found it, and you still love it today. That's a good choice. They're perfectionists. Anybody else?
Can he play that?
Oh, yes. Yeah, Dan, play a minute of Peg. Like that is you can move your attention to any instrument or voice in the ensemble and hear something good. Not all records can do that.
Michael McDonald.
Yes. I love Michael McDonald. Love him. What a unique voice. Yeah. It sounds boastful. I had the chance to work with him on a record and he was great. He's a great guy. As talented as he is, he's that good of a person. Lovely human. We talk in record making sometimes about some records come out like a sneeze. It's just pchoom, and it's there. And that would be like in painting, like a gesture sketch. It would be like Jean Cocteau doing just a line, and that's supposed to be a bull or something like that. That's a gesture sketch. But then there are these works of art that are massaged, and they are it's like a Steven Spielberg movie or Martin Scorsese or someone. Something like that. Every detail is chosen to be perfect. And it seems like you either fall into one camp or the other. And Steely Dan set the bar for perfection in record making. Other people didn't have the budgets, didn't have the talent, couldn't meet that bar. So we said, well, okay, we'll just do gesture sketches, I guess. And we took a different approach to art because they set that bar so high. Who else do we have wants to share a record they love? Yes, please, I saw your hand come up quickly.
Oh, thanks.
I was thinking of a record by Yes, Close to the Edge album, and the song is called In You and I. And the reason that this really struck me is it starts off, it just takes me on a journey.
Ah.
The whole thing is just, it's epic. I mean, it's 10 minutes long, so it is epic. But it starts off with a very plaintive, it sounds like it's on a dobro or a national steel or something. And then he starts strumming, so you get this whole thing coming in. And then John Anderson's voice, to me, is very, he's got such a high voice.
Mm.
And he's very aesthetic. And I think he's a bit of a syncretist. So when he just takes from everywhere and weaves it in. And so it's like, and you and I climbed over the mountains, and you and I did this. And he knows what's going on in the real world. He mentions that. But we're looking ahead and we're going on this journey.
Mm. Do you think you fell in love with it for the lyrical content, or do you think the sounds, because you mentioned the sounds quite a bit, it's the timbral palette that at least primed the pump for you, your brain said, this is what I'm talking about here. These are the sounds I like, and then they create a visual imagery. And of course, with chord progression and with melody and harmony, they're taking you someplace. They promise in the first few beats, and then they deliver on that promise as the piece unfolds.
Exactly. I listened to it quite a number of times, and then finally I woke up to the fact that he was actually singing the words.
Yeah.
I like what you're singing. If you shut up, I would still love a
song. Right. I like when that happens, when you love a record and somebody says, well, how do the lyrics go? And you're like, you know, I don't know. I know some phrases, but because you're getting your treats elsewhere.
Yes.
Shall we hear a minute of that?
Please.
And you and I? Starts suspenseful. There's that drone going on, I think from the open strings of the guitars, very lightly underneath, suspenseful. Then they go into just a straight up groove, no suspense here at all. Then the melody comes in, and it's almost childlike. It's almost like a da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-dee. It's very simple. That juxtaposition of elements lets you know you're in for some surprise. This isn't what you thought it was going to be. And that's a big part of the excitement of following along. Where are they going to go next? Because of those changes it goes through in the first minute. That's a nice choice. Who else has something they would like to share? Yes, please.
Oh, I was thinking you were talking about how it moves something internally inside of you. Mm-hmm. And how it immediately came to Henry Purcell's Dido's Lament. And in there, it's music that just goes right inside. And I feel almost like it's an internal. I'm not listening to my ears. Something else is moving me when that music plays. In fact, I don't remember the details, but I remember a musicologist once saying that what Purcell did was he arranged a series of notes that were germane to the human rhythm, and that why we all responded on such a visceral level. To my mind, it almost brings me to tears when I hear. Yeah, especially Maggie Lennox.
Oh, can we hear that, Dan? Dido's Lament, Purcell, Annie Lennox? Oh, when did you first fall in love with it? How long ago?
I forget. Just the movie, it's always
it's,
there.
It's been all, it's always there.
Years ago.
Okay, shall we hear it?
Thank you. That what you played reminded me of this.
Thank you.
lament. It sounds like a cry, and she's putting that in her voice. She's not showing off. She's communicating with you. Even if you didn't understand the words she was saying, you'd know what she was saying.
It goes on in that kind of mood. So just, you can almost not recover from it.
Ah.
It's like you've gone through either a tragedy or something that is so exalting that you're never going to be the same.
You know, psychologists are interested in why we like sad music, and they still don't have, there's no consensus, there's no definitive answer. But one of the things that is discussed these days is that experiencing the feeling of being moved connects you to other people. A 3-minute song is going to be over in 3 minutes, and you realize, well, I don't have anything to be sad about right now, but I'm remembering the feeling of sadness, and with that comes an awareness of other people's sadness, and just being moved itself can make us feel closer to other people and more integrated into the human community. It's one of the reasons why we like sad songs. It's gorgeous.
I was just thinking of it. The singer has to almost feel what the song is conveying to resonate with us.
Mm.
And it reminds me of a William McDougall, a psychologist, who once pointed out that there's a resonance in the art itself.
Mm.
There's something in the work of art that has its own genuineness that resonates out to the listener.
Yes, and what you just said is the art of being a record producer who has to listen on behalf of others and try to guess to the best of your gut instinct if these performers are genuinely communicating something rather than just going through the motions. But that said, abstract music today that is made by a machine is beloved by a lot of people, which tells us that it doesn't have to be human expression necessarily in the performance that makes music moving to us. Sound itself, as the late great neuroscientist Jack Panksepp said, sound is a special form of touch. And sound touches lower level circuits that zip right through circuits of the brain responsible for emotion. We feel sound before we think it. So sometimes sounds can be designed, even made by a machine, the sound itself can evoke feelings in us. Lenny, is it a gorgeous choice? Yes, there are more back here. Yes.
One more?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
And then we'll have some Q&A if you've got questions and we've got time.
Yeah, I wanted to. I'm having trouble because I've got a couple of choices.
So I wanted
to introduce you, and maybe because she went to Berkelee. There's a woman that was just won an Emmy. Her name is Lurfey. Do you know Lurfey? She is from Iceland. And she writes her own music. And when I heard her the first time, something just resonated. And she's this young woman writing songs that have a feel of age or something.
Yes.
It's her soul is in her both her voice and her music. And I don't know the song well enough, but the song is called From the Start. And she is a really, well, you've got to look her up.
Okay.
L-A-U-F-E-Y is her name. And but the other song I wanted to know, and you can pick whichever, but is Sinatra's on his Antonio Carlos Jobim album, which to me is one of the best albums of Sinatra in his day, in that time, because his voice changed all the time. And the yearning in the song Changed Partners, that was written by Irving Berlin, and the Nelson Riddle arrangement with it just gets me.
Yeah.
And it's strange because there's a lyric in there that also gets me that I love to sing along with. Ask him to sit this one out, and while you're alone, I'll tell the waiter to tell him he's wanted by the telephone. And for some reason, I just look forward to singing that. But I wanted to share those too, but the Sinatra Jobim album for me is one of the best that you could, especially for a man who was not very likable.
To really
get my heart.
Frank and Ella set the standard for American singers, and very few people have ever come close. Frank had no equal. His recording Live at the Sands, 1965, with a 25-year-old Quincy Jones conducting the Count Basie Orchestra. His version of all of It Was a Very Good Year knocks me out. He's singing about being 17 years old, and he's in a hurry, and he's ahead of the beat because he was a maestro of phrasing. He's ahead of the beat because he's 17 years old. And then he was 25 years old. He's a little mellower. And then he's 35, and now he's in the autumn of his years. The way that voice is taking you through life, and this master of phrasing, and the way young Quincy Jones, just with the band, is like, Quincy knows to tell the band, he leads. Frank leads, we follow, he sets the pace. The synergy there between those musicians and that great, great vocalist is amazing. But I believe Dan has that song up. So let's hear this young Grammy winner. Yes, please.
Don't you notice how I get quiet when there's no one around, me and you and awkward silence. Don't you dare look at me that way. I don't need reminders of how you don't feel the same. Oh, the burning pain, listening to you heart pump out some new soulmate. She's so perfect, blah blah blah. Oh, how I you'll wake up one day. Run to me, confess your love. At least just let me say that when I talk to you, oh Cupid walks right through.
Beautiful. Is that the artist you were thinking of?
It's very strange to me. She's like 26 or 27. Mm. And she's writing this kind of music that a generation. Mm-hmm. Here I am, almost 80 years old, and I'm going, I want to hear everything she writes.
That's so great. The young musicians today, there's some great music being made. Now, most of us, and I think we should take Q&A, most of us who are older, we've got our library. We know where to go for all of our treats. We don't need necessarily to seek out new music to find treats because we've got it in our old music. But every now and then, I know a student will play something for me that I like so much, it does enter into my library. There are those few instances. So does anyone have a question they would like to ask? Yes, please.
So in the listener profile that you put up, how much of that is influenced by the producer versus the artist? And if it is a producer, do the producers have a certain pattern that they may follow with other artists, and that's why you find yourself liking certain musicians or artists that they produced. Mm. The reason I asked this, I saw this show called The Defiant Ones with Jimmy Iovine, and I didn't know he produced all these people in the 70s, like, you know, Tom Petty and Stevie Nicks. But as he was going through, I'm like, this is the soundtrack of my life. I like every one of them. And, you know, I'm a huge Springsteen fan, so it started with that. And I'm wondering how much of that was driven by the producer or the artist or a combination of both. I mean, you know, I would imagine the lyrics of the artist, but how much of the other elements does the producer influence in a record?
Really good question. So Jimmy Iovine was asked in the recording studio once, What's your favorite instrument? Because, you know, people, there's a pause in the action, and people ask general questions, and someone says, well, I like the horns, and someone else said, I like the vocals, or I like the drums, or the strings, and they asked Jimmy Iovine, what's your favorite instrument? And he picked up the phone, and he said this. Jimmy Iovine was primarily known for his executive skills, more so than his musical skills. So the producers got a tough job because they have to take these little seeds that the artist brings into the studio, the songs and the desire to perform the songs, they have to take those seeds and they have to grow them. And you can't grow broccoli from celery seeds. You have to grow what they bring you. But some producers will take those seeds of the artist's impulses and change them enough, often by bringing in other performers. I'm not saying that Jimmy Iovine did this, but it's done frequently. They'll bring in other performers, they'll bring in ghost co-writers, and they will create something that isn't what the artist originally envisioned, but sells, and makes that artist famous and very well known. The artists you're talking about, like Tom Petty and Bruce Springsteen, they knew what they were doing, and they didn't let their music be pulled out of shape by someone else. But to answer your question more directly, sometimes it is the producer who has made a decision that the best way to get this to sell, to get a lot of listeners to like this record, is to treat it this way. And sometimes it's not. Producers are hired for what they bring to the table. And sometimes you need someone to give you a hit. And so you're willing to sacrifice your artistry to let them just give you a hit. And other times, I tended to be hired by artists who didn't want their music pulled out of shape. Rather, I was known for being good at growing the seeds they brought me and pulling the music that they envisioned when they wrote it out of them. I had that strength, and just every now and then would have a hit, but it didn't happen that often. So most of what I did was work with artists who didn't want to be bent out of shape. So yeah, sometimes it's the producer, and sometimes it's the band, and a lot of times it's a little bit of luck. But the term we use for that is a sonic signature. Everyone has a sonic signature. So the producer's going to have his or her own listener profile. And when you're moving that microphone on that guitar amp, when you're listening to that performance, you're keeping a running stream of decision making. And as you're listening to that performance and those tones, you're thinking, no, 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 until suddenly they hit that guitar just right, or they change that part, or you move that mic and you say, yes. What is that? It means the sound you were hearing was in the category, your mental category of not good enough, until it crossed a psychological boundary in your unique profile that made you say, now that's what I'm talking about. Now we're talking. So it's that listener profile that you get hired for, and everyone's is different. That becomes, it's manifested as your sonic signature. What sounds good to you? Is there more questions? Do we have time?
I think I probably need to let you know. She has to drive back to New York this evening. Mm. But hasn't she been excellent?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks. Yeah. Thank you.
Really. We'll have to have you back.
Anytime.
We'll do this again. I think this
Thank
was great.
Thank you very much for coming.
Join us in the back.
Thank you.
Thank you.